Thank you, Andy. Thank you, Mayor, Michael, ma'am. Thank you. Good to be here. As Andy said to you, I used to be a student here, and I was also a teacher. So it's a way of coming back to my early roots and beginning study of psychoanalysis and such. First of all, why? Why am I talking about what I'm talking about? Second, what are my qualifications to talk about this? Third, what am I going to talk about? Why am I talking about this? The reason I'm talking about poetry, what am I going to say? Let me say this. I'm going to talk to you about what I believe poetry is, and therefore, by implication, what poetry is not. What is poetry? What is the definition of poetry? How do we arrive at that definition? How do you understand the definition? What is poetry? That's one area I talk about. Second, what other area I talk about is that if we hear a poem versus recited, or if we read it, but better recited, and if we read a page of prose, often the poetry affects us differently. And the question is why? Why does a poem affect us differently than the prose? Those are the two main questions. And the third question that will automatically therefore come about is that what is the overlap, similarity and difference between conducting psychotherapy and psychoanalysis and writing poetry or listening to poetry? Those are the three main areas. So let's say, let's take a line. There's a line in a poem by Pablo Neruda, says, what is sadder than a train stopped in rain? Now, think about this. I mean, many of you are students of English literature and can teach me about all this, know much more than I do. I'm an ordinary doctor, seeing patients every day. But you know, think about this. What is sadder than a train stopped in rain? If you are too obsessional, if you are too intellectual, if you are too logical and too proper a person, it won't make any sense to you. You have to be a bit crazy, and a bit wild, and a bit weird, and a bit melted and liquid inside to begin to be in touch with what it could mean. What is sadder than a train stopped in rain? Now look at this line. First of all, the pause after sadder. What is sadder? In those three words, what begins to happen is that we suddenly start to feel very smart and get ready to answer the question. We say, I will tell you what is sadder. And our mind becomes agile, sharp, and focused. And we are like in a quiz game on TV. What is sadder? Now everybody is thinking, what is sadder than what I'm going to get into? Then a train stopped in rain. As soon as we hear that, we get shocked and puzzled and we don't know what the question. And we become that train that is stopped in rain. And therefore, in the form of the delivery of the line, is the line itself and is the meaning of the line itself. And this is one very interesting thing about poetry, that in most poetry, what is phonetic, what is prosodic, what is sound related, is also related to what is instinctual, what is psychodynamic, what is content. Here's an example, which is not a poem. Met this guy, his name is Mark Moore. He's a favorite student of mine, now graduated psychoanalyst. He's from Ireland. It's not like Irish American. The first time I met him, I'm talking to him about just getting to know each other. So I asked him, do you have any siblings? He said, yeah, I have a brother. I said, and what does your brother do? He said, well, we like chalk and cheese. Now, I wasn't familiar with this expression. Chalk and cheese. We like chalk and cheese. So I said, excuse me, I'm really not familiar with this expression. Can you tell me what you mean? He says, we are very different. So I said, yeah, I sound like, but I mean, chalk and cheese. then I began to think after he left. And I began to start from this phonetic and ended up on this textual. Think about it. What is the difference in the two words? Don't go to the meaning. Please, no meaning. You know, the rule in psychoanalysis, I suppose, I'm not a literature student, always start from the surface. Always start from the surface. You know, being psychoanalyst, sort of little mean being interested in the depth, but not at the cost of surface. The manifest dream is as valuable as the latent dream. You see? This is the famous Erickson's paper on the dream specimen. Manifest dream has its own value. Latent dream has its own value. The conscious parts of mind have their own value, the unconscious part of their minds. So, chalk and cheese. Chalk and cheese. So just the words. I found, as I repeated after he left these words to me, I become aware of two important phonetic differences in those two words. One is, to say, to utter the word chalk, you have to open your mouth like this. Chalk. Chalk. To utter the word cheese, you have to go cheese. Chalk and cheese. That's one difference that immediately became apparent to me. L.F. Freeman Sharp, and you would know this paper, 1940 paper by L.F. Freeman Sharp, famous British analyst, and if she is not famous, she should be famous. Yeah. Paper called Psychoanalysis, Language and Metaphor, where she talks about how speech can become other bodily functions, and other bodily functions can become speech. Chalk and cheese, one difference that immediately appeared. Second difference that appeared was that chalk ends on K, and therefore, which is a hard consonant. There's nothing to be said after K. The word that ends with K, including fuck, there's nothing to say after that. Fuck, it's over, it's over. Right? Same thing, chalk, finish. It's a hard consonant, and not followed by a vowel. Cheese, especially with Z sound in S, preceded by two E's, and one E, followed by one E, is a softer sound. Cheese, chalk. So two differences became available. One is, and one is, these are two phonetic differences that I became aware between chalk and cheese. Then comes the second level, conscious, pre-conscious, unconscious. Psychoanalyst by the name of Joseph Sandler, he says, always, first analysis is about present conscious, present unconscious, past unconscious. That is how your understanding will go. You can go from present conscious to past unconscious. Not right. So, chalk and cheese. Hard consonant, soft consonant, big sound, diminutive sound, two, three. What does chalk look like? Long. What does cheese look like? Soft and with holes. That's the picture we draw of cheese. We draw a picture of cheese. Cheese. Long, holes. Soft, hard. Do you see what we're talking about? We're talking about elemental, archetypal containers of masculinity and femininity. Chalk is for the word, cheese is for nourishment. Cheese is made of milk, it's a milk product. You're mammals, you're not apples. You see? As you begin to just go from the phonetics to the content, to the instinctual, I became aware that what Mark Moore was saying was that one of them is more defensively phallic and one of them is more defensively maternal, the two brothers. Both are warding off something and both have contained their parental splits of masculinity and femininity inside of themselves. And that's why they're so different. That's how we work at Nikan. So what is sadder than the train stopped in rain? I mean, if you really, really want to get into it, I think this much of scotch is at least needed. Then you begin to have all kinds of ideas, such as, who makes trains? And who makes rain? This is a big question. First of all, is this about a train? That says yes. Is this not about a train? That says yes. Of course, it's about train and not about train. And we'll get into the metaphor, in the place of metaphor in poetry. But it is about train and it's not about train. So let's again start from surface. If it is about train, where is this train coming from? Where is this train going? Who is in the train? Is this a lover going to meet a lover? Is this a child going to meet a dying mother? Is it a man who has shot somebody in the belly in Baltimore and taken a train to run away to New York? What? Who is in the train? Where is the train coming from? Where is the train going? And therefore, why is this stopping of the train sad? Right? Then the next question is, sad for whom? Sad for the persons traveling in the train? Sad for people waiting at the next station? Sad for the engineer who's running the train? Sad for the inventor of the train? And then the question, further as we pull the camera back, who makes trains? Man. Man makes trains. British boy began this teenager. And who makes rain? If you believe in God, then God makes rain. If you don't believe in God, nature, Charles Darwin, O.J. Simpson, whoever you want to call, who makes rain. Right? And therefore, what is this war about? What is this war between train and rain? What does it have to do with nature and man? What has to do with invention and discovery? What does it have to do with what is given and what's created? What has to do with mother and father? What does it have to do with horizontal movement and vertical movement? Do you see all kinds of shit begins to come to the mind? And things begin to happen. And that's how we read from this language. By allowing our mind to take the surface and, like a ramp, keep moving down the ramp again and again and again, going into the labyrinth. Each line of poem and each poem tells us something and hides that very thing. Hides something and tells us that very thing. And that is the idea of poetry. So what is poetry? And give me more examples. So what is poetry? Poetry, to my mind, fundamentally is a bridge between five things. First, it's a bridge between music and prose. It's a bridge between music and prose. So that words are used, like they're used in prose. But words are not used only for their denotative or even for their connotative purposes. Words are used for their cadence, for their sound qualities, for their prosodic value, for their kindling effects. So that words are used not only as words, but also as things. There's a line in my mother tongue's poem, "Kya bane baat, jahan baat banaye na bane." It means, how can there be a conversation when you can barely start? How can there be a relationship where there can be no conversation? Now the poet could have said it many other ways. Pablo Neruda could have said, let me tell you that there is nothing more sadder than a train stopped than a rain. No, he doesn't say it this way. He said, what is sadder than a train stopped in rain? He arranges the words in a certain way, which is the prosodic use of language, the use of language as kindling, reminding us of dim area of our mind, evoking something, hinting at something, touching on something, and using the words as fingers to touch our heart and bodies. Poetry is a bridge between music and prose. So then we have to raise a question, what is music? And what is prose? Where does music come from? And where does prose come from? Music is always related and originates inside the mother's body. The first drum that we have, and drum is the basic musical instrument. Drum is the basic musical instrument. And the first drum we hear is the placental arteries, pulsations. When we are inside our mothers, and all of us, please understand, do not forget, nobody in this room has not been inside a womb. If there's anybody, please raise their hand. All of us are born of women. All of us were once inside a womb. And we have to be very grateful. So, when we are this big, inside mommy, this big, like a little hamster or something, inside our mothers, the artery, the central artery moves. That's our first introduction to music. The second introduction to music is when our mother, you know, we have experiments whereby, regardless of happiness, a left-handed mother, a right-handed mother. When the baby is crying very upset, always takes the baby to the left breast. The left breast has a profoundly more deep psychological importance than the right breast. Although in other aspects, the right has different psychological values. The right arm, right hand, right side. But only with the breast, maternal breast, the left breast is much more psychologically significant because it is above the heart, located above the heart. And the mother takes the baby to the heart. And the baby hears. Two. The placental artery, the heartbeat, then the lullabies. Few words, more tune, more music, lullabies, maternal lullabies. And then the sound of the nature. Musical toy in the crib. Musical toy in the crib. The sound of the nature, the sound of the breeze, the sound of the trees, the wind passing through the bush, the curtains moving, the dogs, the cow, the temple bell. Sounds of the nature, sounds of the environment, sounds of the mother's heart, sounds of the womb, sounds of the lullaby. This is what music is about. This is where music originates. Music is pre-verbal, pre-natal, before words, our introduction to music. Introduction to words happens much later. Introduction to words happens much later. In the primary maternal preoccupation, when a mother begins to lose all aspects of her identity and does not gain them from about 3-4 weeks before birth till after 3-4 months after birth of the baby. The mother forgets, I'm a doctor, I'm a wife, I'm a sister, I'm a citizen, I'm a Democrat or a Republican. All this becomes irrelevant. What becomes important is I'm mother. In that primary maternal preoccupation, the predominant way of communicating with the baby is through sounds, not through words, sounds. Sounds. This is laying down the musical substrate of the mind. On which, then, if you like Lacan, I apologize, but may the Lord be with you. But, you know, the idea is, the language appears slightly later, whether you call it that is necessarily maternal, necessarily masculine, necessarily the representative of the law-giving father. I think there are biases in that, but nonetheless, something is true also there. And therefore, these two, the music and the prose, the mother and the father, the masculine and the feminine, this is the bridge that poetry tries to build between music and the prose. Borrows words, takes it to music, puts it in. It's like you're sitting, standing next to a well. There's water far deep, and you take a bucket and throw it, and now you pull it out, and a lot of water actually falls out again. But some water comes out. Which brings the second bridging function of the poetry, and then with that in between, the pre-verbal era of our life, the so-called unrememberable but unforgettable. It is unrememberable because it was not recorded in languages in which we record. Look at a baby, 6 months old, 4 months old. You think baby's not thinking? Of course baby is thinking. You think baby is not figuring things out, trying to sort things out? Of course the baby is. So is a dog. I have a dog, and a curious coincidence, Mayor and I have a dog which is named the same name. An old Arabic lover, Iraqi lover called Majnoon, which literally means mad, one with insanity. Majnoon, one with insanity, gone mad. Now, when I look at Majnoon, it's obvious that he's thinking. He's not thinking in English, most likely. He knows some English words. He has a vocabulary of about 20 words he knows. But he's thinking, and he is planning, and he has ideas, and he has feelings and impulses, and plans, and devices. And he can be very sweet and seductive, and he can be very obnoxious. He's only obnoxious in that I'm very Kotian. He's only obnoxious when I'm not attuned. He's not internally obnoxious, I don't think so. He's only when I'm in bad mood, then he becomes more aggressively demanding. Play with me, hit the ball. But I'm in good mood, he's fine. He's fine. In fact, if you want to read something good about dogs, I just read this paper coming on the train. So good, by an Italian psychoanalyst, Stefano Bolognini. Fabulous paper on dogs. So, the pre-verbal area remains inside of us. And then a verbal layer is imposed upon. But this thing remains, and this thing has to be accounted for. It lives inside of us. It shows in our thermal sensitivity. It shows in our postural preferences. It shows in a furtive shadow that moves around our eyes certain times. It shows in the pain around the mouth. It shows, it is there. That element has to be captured. And somehow we seek to make one of ourselves because we are split in parts. And in that adaptive anagogic striving, poetry plays a role. It pulls some of the pre-verbal experience into the verbal realm. Not very successfully, but tries. So that's the second thing poetry bridges. Third. The third thing the poetry bridges is on a neurophysiological level, between right brain functions and left brain functions. Or turn within psychoanalytic metaphor between primary process thinking and secondary process thinking. This is Freud in 1915 described this phenomenon in great detail, that how the conscious mind works in a different way according to different rules and how the unconscious mind works according to different rules. The conscious mind works with logic, with having contradictions, with a temporal organization, with a sequential progression, with layering of material. Those are, and with sorting out things as separate categories and predominantly organized in words. The unconscious mind, on the other hand, works completely in different way. It doesn't have words. It only has sensate and sensual experiences and things. And there's no contradiction, and there's no time, and there's no organization. One thing can become another. Think about it. Somebody burns a United States flag in Pakistan. You get pissed off. First of all, the flag was most likely made in China. Think of the background. The Chinese should be pissed off. Why are you getting pissed off? It was not made in USA. The silk most likely came from Bangladesh, and the flag was printed in China. It's nothing to do with us. But we get pissed off. Because we have thought that that flag is equal to USA, is equal to us, is equal to our good mom, equal to daddy. You see, that's what Freud means, that this condensation in the unconscious. How small thing can stand for big thing can small thing stand for big thing. Logical level, you should be upset at all. Right? China can not burn anybody. To the run, they're only burning flag, who cares? Don't burn us, or burn the flag. That's the conscious part. The unconscious. In the prose, it doesn't make any difference. In the poetry, it makes a profound difference. That's why I tell my candidates, residents that were learning to do psychotherapy and psychoanalysis, every word the patient says, every sentence. Listen as if the patient is speaking in prose, and then listen as if the patient is speaking in poetry, and tell me the difference. And you will find the difference. You will find the difference. So, between music and prose, between known and unknown, pre-verbal and verbal, between what is unconscious and conscious, between right brain and left brain functions, you know, and ultimately, I think the brain is between duality or merger and fusion versus separateness, individuality, individuation, authenticity, and separation. We all begin our life. I mean, where does a baby come from? Where does a baby really come from? Think about it. You know, I'm not talking like anatomy and physiology and gynecology. That's not my field. I'm a doctor, but I'm a doctor of the mind. And I'm not ashamed of being a psychiatrist. You know, I'm interested in mind. That's enough things. So I've lost interest in physical medicine altogether. In fact, I'm not even interested in brain. I am not interested in brain at all. You know, my daughter moved to Portland, Oregon, and took some of her stuff in U-Haul. She didn't move there because she had a U-Haul, right? I mean, she didn't move to Portland because she found a U-Haul. No, that's what brain is about. Brain is like U-Haul. I'm not interested in U-Haul. I'm not into that. I'm interested in mind. I mean, being doctor of mind is enough. You know, if I were interested in brain, I would be a neurologist. So now, what happens is that where does a baby come from? A baby is a rainfall. You see, the vast majority of our body is water. You know, people who are here, the real doctors of body, will know 60%, 70% of our body's whole thing is water. So when we die, if we are cremated, that water is evaporated in the air. If we are buried, the water is bit by bit absorbed by the land. And then, the sun sucks that water up, and we turn into clouds. And then from those clouds, we descend back into the earth as a raindrop. And then, that raindrop can fall on a garbage can, the raindrop can fall on the shining hood of a black Mercedes, or the raindrop can fall on a beautiful lake. Fortunate are those raindrops that fall on lake, because they become one, the lake becomes one. That's the primary maternal preoccupation. Mommy becomes no, and the baby goes no. But both become one. That's called dual unity. Mommy and baby become one. Without that oneness, the baby cannot begin. Mommy has to go down to meet the baby. Remember when E.T. came? Where did E.T. come? In the tool shed. Not in the living room. No. Not in the living room, not in the kitchen, in the tool shed in the backyard. And who brought him out? Children. Father or mother had gone to bring E.T. out, he would have been scared shitless. No, children went. Elliot was the name of the boy, right? He goes, he makes fun of E.T., and bit by bit, E.T. comes to the living room. Same thing, mommy goes in primary maternal preoccupation, brings the baby up. So, there is dual unity. First, the baby and mommy are one, and then the baby and mommy begin to separate. Poetry. Always, regardless of its content, in the formal structures of poetry, there is always the implicit, unconscious message. Two things are same, two things are not the same. You and your mother are one, you and your mother are separate. You and your mother are separate, you and your mother are one. Take the constituents of poetry. Meter, rhyme, alliteration, simile, metaphor, line break, onomatopoeia, anything. You take any constituent of poetry, meta-constituent of poetry, and you will find that each constituent is doing the same thing actually, in different disguise. Each constituent is doing exactly the same thing. It's like you see a movie. Each person is acting. Some is acting good, some is acting bad, some is acting love, some is acting hate, but everybody's acting. Same thing is, each constituent is doing the same thing. What is the same thing? Two things are one, two things are not. What is rhyme? It ends on a word which has same vowels but different consonants. What's alliteration? It becomes the same consonants but different vowels. Same, different, same, different. Everything has to do with sameness and difference, sameness and difference, difference and sameness, sameness and difference. Two things are one, two things are separate. And in that, some liminal message, like satanic verses written in songs, you know, in CDs, it's not true. Like that, is a kindling of the human spirit. And a balm, a salve, an ointment against the wound that we are all on. We are all on. A balm against that wound and a gentle reminder of our separateness and authenticity. And it's both functions. Listen to this poem. There's a line of Verlaine's that I shall never remember again. There is a line of Verlaine's that I shall never remember again. There is a mirror that has seen my face for the last time. There is a door that I have closed till the end of this world. There is a street on which the sound of my footsteps are banned forever. There are books in my library, and I'm looking at some of them now that I shall never read again. This year, I turn 52. Death invades me constantly. It's a powerful poem. It's a powerful poem. And the poem is called Limits. And in some ways, the poem is a constant reminder of the bloody, knife-filled passage of time that cuts us and reduces us. On the other hand, it is also a great celebration. Memory of triumph of authenticity or of survival in exile from love, from familiar objects, from youth, exile from all, and yet alive, wanting to face death, ready to face death. And that is the same, different, 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 same. Here's another line from another poet. I offer you the memory of a yellow rose seen before you were born. I offer you the memory of a yellow rose seen before you were born. I offer you the moon of my ragged suburbs. I offer you the loyalty of a man who has never been loyal. Don't you see? I'm trying to bribe him with danger and defeat. This is going to make you drink. Unless you smoke pot. Let me make this smoke pot. Four lines will drive you away. That's why the Saudis are terrified of poetry. They can't handle this kind of stuff. Because it wakes all kinds of shit up. Think about it. I offer you the memory of a yellow rose seen long before you were born. I offer you the moon of my ragged suburbs. I offer you the loyalty. Was never been loyal. Don't you see? I'm trying to bribe you in danger and defeat. You see this? Take the first line. I offer you the memory of a yellow rose seen long before you. Is there an incestuous love here? Is there Oedipal problem here? Is it an old man falling in love with a 40 years younger woman? And what was that yellow rose? Was it a rose? Or was that the moon? It's now passive time. Where is the Oedipal triangle? Where is the incestuous boundary? And why, on the one hand, is the cockiness breaking Oedipal boundaries and transgressions across age and generations? And yet, the humility of offering the flower. You see, is this arrogance terrible arrogance, or is it narcissistic humility? Is the man claiming or is the man offering? And that is always the tension in the structure of poetry and in the elements of context. Always two-sidedness. In my mother tongue, there's the two lines actually. Apologize for inverting. Ek ek misre mein imtihan hai dil ka. Ek ek misre mein imtihan hai dil ka. Ek baat kehni hai aur wohi chhupani. That means in every line there's a big ordeal for the heart, because I have to say something and hide that very thing. Ek ek misre mein imtihan hai dil ka. Ek baat kehni hai aur wohi chhupani. This is in this line. You know, you can write the goddamn paper on this line. I offer you a memory of a yellow rose seen long ago. He says many, many things in this. I offer you the loyalty of a man who has never been poet. Is this true? Is a man being truthful and honest for the first time and therefore is worthy of allowing you to come and become one? And his goodness to be seen? Has he now finally become good because he knows he's bad? Or is he still being bad? And tricky. You see, A and B. Constantly find this approach. Why does poetry, listening to poetry, hearing poetry, has a different effect than listening to prose? Just think about it. The way I've taught in prose, I've taught in poetry. But when I've recited a poem, it has affected you at a different level. See, listening to prose is like taking steroid pills, corticosteroid pills, 2 pills every day for the pain in the shoulder. Listening to poetry is like getting an injection in the joint. It goes straight inside the joint. It has a different effect. You know, Freud had written how two people's unconscious can communicate without the conscious knowing that they are conscious communicating. It's 1912. Same thing with poetry. It communicates at a different level. It bypasses some censorships. So, contrary to those of Sandler, here, in technical procedure, we go this way. But in poetic procedure, we can go this way. It's like route 2 or 2 bypass. It can bypass many censorships. Evoke and touch certain areas of the mind that we are not always in contact. You listen to a poem, it suddenly moves in a different way. And what happens? Psychotherapy and psychoanalysis. When we are doing psychotherapy and psychoanalysis, it's a tedium. It is not so elegant as movies make it appear. It's bit by bit, it is sometimes dull, tedious and boring. It is hard, painful sometimes, frustrating, and we work and good. We persist and we work. And we work with goodwill and willing to tolerate, bear the suffering that is in the course of the work, and hopefully something will happen. But when it works, and in the moments it works, it is like a poem is born between two people. I give you small examples. Jewish man in psychotherapy, psychoanalysis, very anti-Semitic, has turned himself into, through various maneuvers, into a wasp. So that he uses his middle name, which is more can be Christian, can be Jewish. So he never uses his first name, which is clearly Jewish, and hardly mentions his last name, which is Jewish. He uses his middle name, which is more ambiguous. He dresses in a way which he believes is the Christian wasp way of dressing. He has a car which he believes is a Christian looking car. So he has turned himself into completely avoiding his Jewishness and is very anti-Semitic. So, but that's not the main problem. That's the problem, byproduct. We work on things and this thing comes and goes in treatment. Gradually this thing now becomes central part of the treatment. And for a while, all sorts of things begin to come out about it, and bit by bit, as changes begin to happen, he becomes more comfortable. He becomes more comfortable for the first time, so 3 years of the treatment, he joins the synagogue, he starts to use his first name with people, and so on and so forth. Around that time, he finds out that I'm straight. It freaks him out. Now he's totally ashamed. Or for me, he's deeply ashamed that I'm straight. So I ask him, one time he's talking, and he's talking about himself. So he says, he's on the couch, and he says, "Oh, incidentally, I want to let you know one thing. I am not ashamed of being a Jew." So I said, "This sounds like something Richard Nixon could have said." Now, the patient is smart, so he immediately gets it. You guys are, some of you are very young. There was this famous sentence by Richard Nixon, "Yeah, the people of this country need to know whether the president is a crook or not. Well, I'm not a crook." So that's the sentence I was referring to. And the patient gets it, a smart guy, immediately understands, laughs. Then says, "So you think I still am?" I said, "I fear that some of that lingers in you. I fear that." And since in the previous session or session before we were talking about how ashamed you are that I'm Muslim, I think that this your shame about being a Jew and your shame on my behalf for being a Muslim, I think they have something to do with it. And I think for the kind of work we've undertaken, we might try to think together as to what these two things have to do with each other. And then, up to here, I was talking in prose. Up to here, I'm talking in prose. Inadvertently, three words popped out of my mouth. I said, "And for the work we are doing, I think it's worthwhile for us to begin thinking as to what is your shame about being a Jew and what is your shame for my being a Muslim have to do with each other." Unbeknown to me, unintentionally, I said the three words. "Are they sisters?" Now, once I said, "Are they sisters?" this became very peculiar to me, to myself. Why did I say, "Are they sisters?" This is a kind of weird thing to say. So, talk and tease, we have to start from the surface. I was talking about shame. The word for shame in my mother tongue has two connotations, and I was talking of two shames. One is called sharm, which is actually closer to shame, and one is called haya, which has to do with shyness. Now, shame and shyness are kind of one dimension. I think shame is the ugly sister of shyness. But why not a brother? Are there two brothers? The reason I couldn't have said that "are they brothers" was because the word sharm or haya in my language, all the words have a gender. Sharm aati hai, haya aati hai. That means they are feminine words. And therefore, the word that popped out in my head, I was just trying to establish a jointness, but unconsciously, "are they sisters?" Because my mind is originally organized. So this is a poetic moment where the unspoken part, an Urdu part of me, which was not in my consciousness, lays claim to an emotional moment. Says, "Me too, I have to be here also." And that pushes the language further, adds three words, but turns the English into other systems. Take another example. I have this woman, and it's important to let you know this woman is not from India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh. So not from Indian subcontinent. You will see why I let you know. The white American woman. Very lonely person. Very, very lonely. And has pretty much had no relationship till about age 40 or so. At 40 she has an affair with a married man. Very limited, romantic, intense sexual affair. Very, very limited, but it's good for her. That's all she wants. And it remains very good for about a year and a half. And then the man disappears, vanishes. Gone, bye-bye. Can be traced. She becomes very depressed. That's when she starts, for the first time, at age 42, 43, psychotherapy. She interesting that somewhere around 2 years in the treatment, she acquires a bird. She has no friends. Goes to work, comes home, period. Lives an absolutely and abjectly self private life. She acquires a bird, falls in love with the bird, talks about the bird in very anthropomorphized, very human terms. You know, he doesn't like when I'm watching TV, or if I watch TV for too long, he gets very upset. Or he saw me crying, so he came and sat next to me. He gave me solace, he's very sweet, and so on. Never do I make any interpretation of this bird. You have to. You see, you become a psychoanalyst, bit by bit you learn what to analyze, what not to analyze. Both things are important. You know? So, just like in cooking food, you know what to put, but you also should know what not to put. You know? So, this I just know. So now, what happens is, one day, the bird dies. She's very upset, of course, and she cannot get rid of the bird's body. So she puts the bird's body in a fridge. And the bird remains in the fridge. Now, I can assure you that if had it happened 20 years ago, I would have felt it to be a great therapeutic trophy the day she got rid of this bird from the fridge. Now, frankly, I don't give a damn. First of all, almost all people in this room have some dead birds in their fridge. Chicken. Who doesn't have a dead bird in their fridge? Simply because it is given, and simply because the feathers are taken off, that doesn't mean it's not a dead bird. Right? Everybody is a dead bird. So, and I'm not a Maytag man, I'm not the refrigerator repair man, I'm a psychologist. What do I care what she puts in a fridge? None of my business. I'm interested in what's inside of her. So we work, and some days she talks about the bird's body in the fridge, some days she doesn't, and we go on. And the 6 months pass. One day, she comes and says the following. Yesterday I went back from work, and I was sitting alone, looking downstairs from the building, on the traffic, and suddenly from the corner of my eye, you're not a psychoanalyst. That's why you go like this. Every psychoanalyst knows corner means where you're sitting, right? With your chair in the corner. So, corner of my eye, I catch the glimpse of a little spider. And I found this spider to be very beautiful. It was very dark. Corner. I'm listening. I'm a psychoanalyst. It's my job. So I'm listening. From the corner of my eye, I saw the glimpse of a spider. The spider was very dark color. And I started looking at the spider, and I got very enamored by the spider. I'm listening. Then she says, then a thought occurred to me. And this is why I told you the patient is not from India and so on. Then a thought occurred to me, maybe it is my bird, Dino, who has come back reincarnated at this time to meet me. Now the patient is sitting, she's not looking at me, she's talking to almost herself. This spider, maybe is the reincarnation of my bird, Dino. Maybe Dino became a spider to come and meet me. No, I don't think that there is such a thing as reincarnation. I don't think so. And in any case, I mean, I don't think birds can become spiders. I think that's absurd. But you know, we never know. Maybe it's possible. She looks at me. You don't think I'm crazy, do you? And I said, and in fact, the fact that I said is wrong. Because to say I said attributes and imputes to what I'm telling you a greater amount of self-agency, or at least greater amount of self-conscious agency and aware agency than I had. It was said by me. It was said by me, the following. No, I don't think you're crazy at all. In fact, I think this spider is actually a poem. This spider is actually a poem. She burst into big grin, up to here, eyes shone, bright eyes, big smile, within 2 seconds more. She said, what do you mean? The God honest truth is, I did not know what I meant. Now I know. I didn't know. So I said the following to her. This time I spoke out of agency. So I said, you know, when I said that this is spiders and poor, I could see in your eyes that you knew exactly what I was talking about. You understood it fully. But you are a very self-destructive person. You're very masochistic and very self-destructive. So you destroy it. You could not bear the pleasure of our mutuality and bear the pleasure of your own intelligence. And you destroyed it. So now the question is, can you go back inside of yourself and find what you understood when I said this spider is a pawn? How would you like my help to find that? And the session. But to have said that this is spider is a pawn was a moment of poetry. Was a moment. Because it brought something unknown from within me and within us and put it into knowable step towards knowing. And yet, something elusive. Was the spider a pawn? Yes. Was the spider not a pawn? No. Was the spider the bird? Yes. Was the spider a bird? No. And if you want to become real, better card-carrying psychologist, you would know that I couldn't have said it. Unless I have not left Charlotte Square and back to my little boy when he was 4 or 5 years old hundreds of times. And without having Charlotte Square inside of me, deeply ingrained, I could have said it. Without having a profound love for the country called Holland, for various reasons, beginning from my 5 years of age, I couldn't have known that there was an artist by the name of M.C. Escher, whose house I visited in a little town in what is called Barn, B-A-A-R-N. You know Barn? Okay, you're nodding. Okay, then Barn. Yeah. And he could make anything into anything. A hand into a bird into an envelope into a, you know, something else. Without Holland inside of me and without Charles Webb inside of me, I perhaps would not be open to this kind of thing, and without Hinduism inside of you. You know, if you're born in India, 3 things go inside of you the moment you're born. You breathe, cricket, God, and tuberculosis. There's no Indian. There's no Indian who's not Hindu. All Indians are Hindus. They're Hindu Christians, Hindu Sikhs, Hindu Jews, Hindu Muslims. All Indians. Hinduism, tuberculosis, and so without the Hinduism in me, without Shakespeare, and without without the Holland inside of me, I couldn't have said it. But that's a retrospective revisionist deconstruction. That's a different ball game. We are back in the prose. The moment when I said that this is by the actually a poem, that was a moment of poetry. So what's the difference between psychiatry with both psychoanalysis and both poetry have 3 major similarities. One is both are very formal. Both are very formal. 4 times a week, 5 times a week, on the couch, abstinence, you can't drink, can't smoke, lie down, talk, I'm sitting here, formal structure. There are even rules that you can break of interpretation, rooms of listening that you can play and such, but rooms, formal, poetry has formality. Paradoxically, there's utter freedom. Here, Donald Winnicott, the British pediatrician, being a psychoanalyst, comes to our rescue. And that is, this is a very important thing for young people, keep this in mind, don't ever confuse a game and a play for different things. Game is one thing, play is another. Unbelievable, genius people are there. There's a different thing called game, there's a different thing called play. A game is a formal structure, conceptually and mutually and societally agreed upon. A play is a wild thing within the rules of the game. You know, when John Madden is saying that, you know, Randall Cunningham or Donald McNabb or somebody is running this way, he's not running this way or that way. He's saving ass. The commentator in the box knows the theory, but for the player, the theory is in the body. It's an implicit memory. Same thing. You see, both poetry and psychoanalysis are very formal as games, very wild. as place. Both of them are interested in the relationship of body and mind. Both are related in this relationship between the knowable and unknowable, between the silent parts of the mind and the speaking parts of the mind, between masculinity and femininity, between maleness and femaleness, between memory and fantasy. Therefore, psychoanalysis is two people's poetry. Poetry is one person's psychoanalysis. And function is always of growth and such. Soothing is there. Soothing is certainly involved. You go to your analyst, you feel safe. You feel that this is a place where you can say anything. You may not ridicule, you will not be made fun of. Same way in poetry, there's soothing. But movement is towards knowledge. So here's a poem, 3-line poem, by Emily Dickinson, which tells you what poetry is about. 3 lines. Pain, so utter. And if you see the script, you'll see what the word pain is written. There's a line. And then it says, so utter. And this line has a purpose. This line has a purpose. Pain, so utter, it swallows the substance up, then covers the abyss with trance. Amazing. Pain, so utter, it swallows the substance up. Jab fikre dilo jaan mein fukam bhul gayi. Pain, so utter, it swallows the substance up, and then covers the abyss with trance. That dash, that little line, tells us that the pain has destroyed the mind. And no word is coming to mind. We have moved away from word representations into thing representations. The line stands for distance, for separateness, for wordlessness. The line is the word and should be made into a word later on. You see? Pain cuts the mind so utterly, swallows the substance. And covers the abyss, the trance. So, trance is a part of poetry. Sensual excitement, sensual pleasure, maternal soothing and paternal excitement is part of the poetry. But that's not the only part. The ultimate part is information. Information about the state of affairs within oneself. Insight, opening up of new ways of thinking, new ways of knowing somebody else and knowing oneself. And therefore, the title of this talk. Seamus Heaney was asked, what is the purpose of poetry? And he said, it is to take a few steps from delight to mystery. Thank you very much.
Questions, comments, dreams, planning, wild, anything from any of you. Yes?
The chalk may catch his head.
Yeah. You know, cheese in our mother tongue means paint. So, different means, so he's playing with the words. उसका जवाब से भेज दिया जा सकता है कि चीज का दामन चाक है बट यप
आई वाज इन सोशल साइकोलॉजी क्लास
यस
लास्ट सेमेस्टर प्रोफेसर विल्सन एंड वी कवर समथिंग कॉल्ड राइटिंग थेरेपी आई थिंक द पेनबेकर लाइक फॉर समवन हुज हैविंग प्रॉब्लम्स राइट्स हैव दैट प्रॉब्लम एवरी नाइट फॉर 4 नाइट्स एंड देन आफ्टर दैट पीरियड दे फील बेटर बिकॉज़ दे काइंड ऑफ लाइक ordered their experience.
Yeah.
I just want to know what you thought of that. It seems similar to what you were talking about.
See, I think it brings to my mind there's a ritual in Guatemala in which there's a little box, and the box has 9 doors. Okay? And every night you go to sleep, whatever is bothering you, you tell them, goes, you feel better. You really do feel better. I haven't tried it. I'm thinking you'll try it. You know, but these nine dolls, you tell them, look, I'm very upset about such and such thing. Just talk to them and go to sleep. Now, why does that make one feel better? Think of the psychologist. First of all, when you're saying nine dolls, they're not 17, 34, 68. It's just nine. And they remain nine every night. So then there is some kind of limit and formula structure being put. You are not allowed to have more than nine problems. Come on. Right? So that's already reassuring. They're already containing you. Secondly, when you tell those lords your problems, you have in a way cathartically given them up. You have at least vomited them out. Right? So the bug is not inside of you, or less inside of you. Then there is sleep. So there is some kind of implication in the ritual that during the sleep, these nine dolls will work on your problem, right? And by the time you'll have a dream, you'll have something, and you'll be better. So as far as writing therapy is concerned, I am not so convinced that it's the actual writing that is helping, you know? Meaning the content. It may have thought on some things, but it is the fact that one is doing something with some hope, you know? And externalizing something in the hope, unconscious, of re-internalizing. But I wouldn't recommend these kind of things. These things happen. The bird that my patient got who was lonely, I didn't tell her to buy a bird. She bought a bird as she was getting it. These things happen spontaneously. And then they are more from inside, and therefore more valuable. Like the Guatemalan doll thing, you and I do, it'll be a different thing. Because it's not part of your culture and my culture. It will be a foreign thing. But for a Guatemalan person, it will be more powerful. Because it's from within the culture itself, in culture.
Could you comment on your thoughts about poetry being as opposed to prose, more of a containing and holding environment, whereas prose is more open and fluid, but poetry is. I was just thinking that in terms of psychoanalysis.
Yeah. See, poetry, good poetry, you'll find, is an optimal mixture of primary process and secondary process, of the unconscious ways of working and the conscious ways of working of the mind. If there's too much conscious ways of working of mind, then it becomes too pedantic or too oratorial or sermon-like. Nahar par chal rahi hai panchakki, dhun ki puri hai kaan ki pakki. I think it's a fantastically organized shape, but it doesn't have anything in it. You know? So it becomes totally either pedantic description of reality, even of internal reality, just a pedantic description. You know? It's not layered, you know? Not layered. You know? If it is too secondary process. Sermon-like, oratorial, agent-based. As against, if it has too much unconscious, then it becomes autistic and bizarre. You cannot understand what the hell it means. Yeah? What the hell it means. So some mixture has to happen in order for the unconscious and conscious to make some kind of compromise, you know, which is a metaphor, right? Where, see, unlike simile, which is kind of a shy and weak metaphor, where something is like something, here is implied that this thing is that thing, while knowing this thing is not that thing. Right? So then you move to a higher level of abstraction. So there is both greater expression and greater containment than prose, I think. And therefore, more mommy and more daddy. Daddy is more hidden. Mommy is more open, but daddy is there. And that's what Radhi Falkati is. Structure and limits and boundaries.
Karen?
You speak so eloquently, I to offer an invitation, but I feel that although I love what you say about poetry, as someone who studies and teaches prose, I feel like you flatten prose. I don't know why you wouldn't say exactly what you just said about poetry, about prose. There's good and bad prose, and the best prose mixes lyric and order. And you get something like Dickens, or Dostoevsky, or the Brontes, or, I mean, there are prose writers. writers have every, it seems to me, every bit as much reach and complexity as poetry.
First of all, I'm not a literature student. You obviously know this matter far more. So, and my eloquence should not inhibit, in fact, it should elicit attack and question, because that will humble me and make me want to learn more and read more. Quickly thinking, I have two responses. One is, I think when the prose is very good, it's like poetry. Now you can say, now you're cheating. You know, maybe I am cheating, and maybe I'm not. Now here, I just finished this novel. And I thought, very nice novel. I have a sense that women didn't like this novel as much as men did. The novel by Julian Barnes called The Sense of an Ending. But the last three sentences shook me up. They're short sentences. And I could imagine, if he handwrites or he's in the computer, I want to imagine he handwrites, because I like to write everything with hand. And there's something more writerly about writing with hand. So, I'm too young. But you know, so the last three sentences are this. There is accumulation. Period. There's accumulation. Next sentence. Then there is responsibility. And then there is unrest. There is great unrest. I was blown over by this. How the author ends this, when he must have written, that's what my construction is. There is accumulation, then there is responsibility. There's accumulation followed by responsibility, then there is unrest. Period. You could have ended the book here. There's unrest. No, he said there's unrest, period. There's great unrest. And that extra wallop of kindling, moving, putting the hand inside the chest and touching the heart, I thought it was poetic. So I'm biased. You know, to me, when great prose becomes great prose in approaches, that's one. The second question that arises is also an interesting one. If we say that they're so akin, then there's a problem. How is it possible then, you tell me, that there have been great writers in prose who have written great prose? I can name at least 10. Samuel Beckett, Nabokov, Rushdie, Ionesco, Solzhenitsyn, a huge number of people who have written fantastic prose, in a language that was not their mother tongue. There are hardly any great poet who has written great poetry in a language that's not their mother tongue. There's a mystery in that. Because I think it goes someplace, it comes from someplace else. You know? And therefore, translating a poem is a bloody business. I mean, some of the Latin American poets have been fortunate, they have some good translators. You try to translate poetry across languages, it gets mostly butchered. The two lines, mana ki rang rang tera pehrahan bhi hai. Mana ki rang rang tera pehrahan bhi hai, aur isme kuch karishma hi akse badal di hai. Now, you can translate it, I understand that the dress you're wearing is so colorful, so vibrant, so alive. But by God, the glow of your body also comes through it. Is that the same thing? Of course not. But it's me, which karishma se badal diya. So there's something, I think, I mean, I'm not a student of this. You can teach me, I'll sit at your feet, and you can teach me for years. But I think there's something different. Now, maybe I'm idealizing poetry because my father, the great poet, was. Just it is, the poet he lives. But my mother was a great prose writer. And actually, I think I love my mother more. I love them both. They were both great writers. So maybe there's something that I should go through. Yeah, but you put me in touch with something good. And that's one advantage of doing these kinds of talks. One gets asked a question.
Thank you for coming. Earlier you were talking about your psychotherapy sessions and how in some ways you use prose for the surface level of what they say, and other times you use poetry. And I was wondering, when you are psychoanalyzing, do you listen to the stories and interpret what people are feeling and what is lying beneath on the basis of the stories, or do you interpret on the basis of those words which slip out as a way of kind of elucidating how much the prose of what they say matters in comparison to
In this example, the man says, you know, I truly, truly love my mother. That is very bothersome. That's very bothersome, isn't it? I really do love my wife. Horrible. Really do love my wife? Love my wife? What is really and do doing there? Right? What is this heavy stone suppressing? You know, I really do love my mother. Or a man says, all I want from my wife is 10 minutes of attention when I arrive at my home. That's all he wants? No, come on. He's trying to tell you what a noble soul he is, what a humble folk he is. Have mercy on them and be on their side. Right? He's seducing you. That's what's going on. With the homosexual seduction, he's saying, all I want from my wife is 10 minutes, meaning you love me. Let the bitch go, you love me. We have to listen to many levels. Always to prose and always to poetry. Person talks for 10 days, he's buying a house. Describes the plumbing, describes this thing, describes that thing, everything about the house. Legal things, contract, this, that. Never tells me how much the house cost. What's missing is also absent. Right? That's the line break or the dash. We listen to what's missing, what's exaggerated, what tone is used, right? So we listen to both poetry and prose.
Do you ever do psychoanalysis in movies?
I have done one analysis almost completely Mughal. One where the person was born and raised in Pakistan, then till about 10 or 11 years of age, then moved to another country, and then came to the Siaf at age 21, 22. 10 years they lived in another country. That person spoke for first 1 or 2 years only in English. And one day, shocked the hell out of me. The person comes, says, from today onwards, I'm going to speak only English. It didn't last. She reverted back to English. But that was very interesting. And one person who will speak off and on, like Rushdie, Salman Rushdie, mixed Urdu and English. Doing analysis one brief psychotherapy was very good for me in both ways, in humbling me, because to conduct analysis in a language that's not my mother tongue, I found in retrospect still has kept me from the distance of intimacy, and therefore to be doing this work in Urdu was much, much more intimate. And I started respecting my American colleagues much more from that universe, you know, because they are dealing with the real McCoy. And I'm like dealing with the real McCoy, right? There's a different thing. There's a linguistic sheet, a thin lexical condom around it, if you will. around the situation. So that there's a little bit of difference in this way. And then, so one was this intimacy level. And second was that I found that I enjoyed it much better. And it was, I could speak much better and more sharply and more clearly. Also, I would use Urdu poetry much more. And one time my aunt, who's a PhD in economics from London School of Economics, now a retired woman, she's about 90, she turned a writer at 75. And has written now 5-6 good books. She calls me, she says about a close relative of hers, one of our cousins and all, that she brought up as a child. And she says, you know, he drives by my home, he's become so famous, he never stopped by even to say hello to me. It hurts me, I raised him as my boy. Should I talk to him about this? And I said, you know, I'll say it to my mother tongue and I'll translate it. I said, Amma, as I have came, गालिब का एक शेर है कि निकाला चाहता है काम क्या कानों से तू गालिब तेरे बेमहर कहने से वो तुझ पे मेहरबान क्यों हो इसको कागज पे लिख लीजिए और दिन में 3 बार पढ़ लीजिए सो आई सेड दैट देयर टू लाइंस फ्रॉम दिस ग्रेट बॉय बोर्न इन 1875 डाई 1895 आई थिंक something and died in 1869. Sorry, 1795 and 1869. He died the year Gandhi was born. That's why Gandhi didn't drink, because Gandhi hadn't finished drinking of that soup. So now, so I told my aunt that there are these two lines of great poets. Says, what are you trying to get out of being sarcastic? And if you call that person, that you're being very cruel, would that turn them into a kind person? I said, write this down and read it three times a day. That's what you need. Now, that is a kind of a joke between relatives. But in genuine work, I suppose I could do more Urdu poetry, which made me fuller as an analyst, if I would be an analyst in the world.
We have a reception on the other side of that wall. On this side of the wall, we have more thanks to give.
Thank you.